Hello, my name is Maciek. I live in Berlin currently, and I work there for a while, an end-to-end encrypted messenger, and I work there in the Android team, even though I write my code in Scala. About two-thirds of why Android code is written in Scala, making it unique among Android apps, like most of them are usually implemented in Java and or Kotlin. Wire is a messenger, and as such, it must be very responsive. It has to quickly react to any events coming from the backend, as well as from the user and from the Android itself. So, during the last 4 years, the Android team developed its own implementation of event streams and so-called signals, a build-up on top of event streams. This talk will be about them, about the theory and practice and some corner cases you may encounter if you want to code your own implementation of it. But it's also a bit about the Wire Signals open source library, which we developed, and that library can do it for you. There are of course other bigger solutions to the same problem, like Akka, Monix, Java RX, or maybe in case of Android, Live Data or Kotlin Flow. Personally, I like Akka very much, but I also think that it's good to start small, and then if needed, you can switch to something bigger, or stay with this smaller solution if it's enough to you. Let's start with a bit of theory. Basically, we are talking here about the observer pattern. You can read all about it in this very old book, Design Patterns, Elements of Reusable Object-Oriented Software, by a so-called Gang of Four. The idea behind this is to solve two problems. How can a one-to-many dependency between objects be defined without making the objects tightly coupled? And how can an object notify an open-ended number of other objects? Open-ended meaning that we don't know how many of them are there, and new ones can pop up at any moment. The main object here is called a producer, or a subject. It's the source of events. The other objects are observers, also known as listeners or subscribers. The terminology is a bit liberal. Some people may even argue that there are differences between those terms, but I think the main reason behind it is that the pattern is with us for a long time and it was implemented in various ways. Here, I will call it simply an event stream and subscribers. We will talk about producers too briefly in a minute. The event stream can produce, or let's say broadcast, an event at any moment. If there are no subscribers present, the event will be wasted. We may say that the event stream does not have an internal state. It does not store the event for future use. It just broadcasts it and forgets about it. But that wouldn't be entirely true. The event stream needs to store the set of references to the subscribers. The set is empty at first, but then any object in the app which fulfills the criteria of being a subscriber can be added to it. Criteria being that it can receive an event of the given type. The subscriber is added to the set, and from now on, every time the event stream broadcasts a new event, the subscriber will receive it. There can be, of course, more than one subscriber. The event will be then sent to all of them. To finish receiving events, the subscriber needs to unsubscribe. The fact that it has to be explicit that the subscriber unsubscribes is a bit of a drawback. In a complex application, the programmer may forget to call it when the subscriber is destroyed or simply stops being needed. In JVM, this may lead to a memory leak. The garbage collector will not be able to collect the subscriber because there will still be a now defunct reference to it in the event stream. We can solve this problem with some sort of automatic unsubscription. We can, for example, model subscriptions as case classes, holding references to both the subscriber and the event stream, and use it to unsubscribe in some sort of onStop methods, or we can use event contexts, implicit objects which oversee subscriptions. You can look into the Wire Signals documentation for more details. But where the events come from. In the original observer pattern, we assume the event stream is also the producer of events. It's even there in the book that we solve a problem of one-to-many dependency. We have one producer that somehow creates the data and sends it away. But producing data and sending are two operations and we can decouple them. So the producer becomes whatever part of the app that can produce the data and then give it to the event stream, and the event stream becomes this object responsible for handling subscribers and broadcasting the events to them. And since now the producer is separate from the event stream, nothing is preventing us from having more than one producer. The connection becomes many-to-many, with the event stream sitting in the middle. This way, producers and subscribers don't have to know about each other. They only have to know about the event stream that operates on data of the given type. But in contrast to subscribers, producers don't even have to register in the event stream. Let's say our producer here is an OKHTTP client. OKHTTP is an HTTP client library very often used on Android. Let's say we have an instance of it and we open a WebSocket, that is a connection to the backend, and we wait for some data from it. So we don't actually produce anything, it's more like another link in a chain, but from the point of view of our Android app, this is how our events are produced. And a subscriber here can be then modeled as a trait and implemented as such, but forcing every class to extend subscriber to enable it to receive events is tedious, it's verbose, we are too lazy for that. Fortunately, we can turn the subscribe method above into a forEach that will take a function. Oh, and I take this opportunity to also introduce the exclamation mark operator as a shorthand for publish. For example, this is now how we can display the event. We can use this forEach to subscribe to the stream, and for example, we can use it this way to display the text of the message in the message view. Okay, at this point you might have had a thought that this subscriber trait here, it's one method trait. So why don't we just turn it into a function itself? Well, yes, I'm usually for it. If our trait turns out to have only one method, I think it means we should really consider turning it into a function. But there's a reason why I didn't do it, and we will talk about it in a moment. But first, transformations. If broadcasting events was all an event stream could do, it wouldn't really be that interesting. Often, subscribers either want to transform the event somehow before using it, and many subscribers may want to transform the event in the same way, or they are interested only in a certain subset of events coming from the event stream, or both. Or the logic can be even more complicated. For example, the event can be interesting to the subscriber only if a certain event from another event source was received before it. To address those needs, event streams implementations come with a long list of methods such as map, flatmap, filter, collect, zip, and so on. With them, you can move the logic which would otherwise have to be implemented in the subscriber to the event stream. In fact, each of them creates a new event stream that has the original one as its producer. The map creates a new event stream that publishes the transformed events, and the filter creates an event stream that publishes an event from the parent only if a certain condition is fulfilled. You may notice how all those methods are basically the same as in the case of standard collections. We can treat an event stream as a collection, as a special kind of collection, but still, you can compare it to a relationship between an option and a future. A collection that has only one or zero elements. The same relationship exists between standard sequence and an event stream, where in case of event stream, we have undefined number of elements, but we don't have access to them immediately, but only after some time. And since we can treat an event stream as a collection, especially that we can use flatmap on it, allows us to use for comprehensions. It might not look like it, because the example is simple. But the ability to use for comprehensions for event streams is a major boost for the readability of our code. Imagine a whole long list of consecutive transformations of event streams, each based on some of the ones executed above, but also on other data. And you can just read it here, just like this, one line, one transformation after another. A moment ago, I skipped over one important issue. I said that a subscriber waits for an event coming from the event stream, but waiting means something different depending on if we talk about working with only one thread or with two or more. Consider this. If this code works on only one thread, we will create a stream in the first line, subscribe to it in the second, and then just after publishing Hello World in the third line, the control will come back to the event stream which will call the println function. The println function will print out the string, and only then the main method will finish. But that's not how modern programs work. In Android, for example, it's customary to work with at least two threads belonging to separate execution contexts. UI and background. The UI thread should be used only to display and refresh things on the screen. If our code does not touch the UI directly, it should work on the background thread. So if we have a list of items we want to display, we do it on the UI thread. But to retrieve those items from the storage, we should use the background thread. You may already see the problem. If we don't have a way to differentiate between UI and background, then when an update happens to the storage, the forEach method of the unchanged event stream and consequently update items on the adapter will be called on the same thread. Fortunately, event streams are exactly the tool we need to jump from one thread to another with little ceremony. We use the forEach method to subscribe to the event stream. That works because forEach method is a bit special. It's different from map and flatmap in one important detail. In standard collections, forEach is called immediately, so no execution context is needed. But in event streams, we can differentiate between the execution context of the source and the execution context of the subscriber. We can implement the forEach so that it will take not only the function to execute, but also a reference to the execution context in which the function should be executed in. When a new event comes, the event stream goes to the collection of those subscribers and forEach calls the function f, but not immediately. Instead, the behavior here is that it wraps the function f in a future and run it in the execution context of the subscriber. So if we have the storage update items, which makes some changes to the items in the storage on the backend thread, and then we have the forEach on the storage unchanged on the UI thread, then that forEach subscribes to the unchanged with the implicit execution context of the UI. And then when the change happens on the background thread, instead of executing that adapter update items on the same thread as the update happened on the background, then we wrap this adapter update items in the future and we call it in execution context of the UI as soon as possible. Of course, there is a special case when the execution context is the same as the subscriber execution context. That possibility can be implemented and used as well, but I would suggest that the one above should be the default one, the one that we wrap the call in the future and let it execute at some point in the future. We shouldn't care about when exactly, just as we don't care about it if the execution contexts are different. So, in a way, this gives us better consistency in how the code behaves, in that we don't know the same details about how it behaves. I'm aware that it does not really answer the question why the subscriber trait cannot be a function instead. The trait is a bit more complicated than the trivial version I presented before, but anyway, I think it could be a function. If there's one way I want while signals to stand out among other libraries like it, it's that I want it to be minimalistic. And at this moment, I think this part of the code seems to be too complicated. I want to work on it, and if you think you can help me in any way, please reach out. And finally, signals. A signal is not a commonly agreed name like an event stream. It's also not an implementation of a popular pattern, just as event streams are an implementation of the observer pattern, but it is a pattern nonetheless. And it's a pattern that came up out of necessity in my work, and it developed quite naturally. We implemented it, tested it, used it in several distinct places in our code, even though arguably all of them within the same Android application. And finally, we documented it and moved the code to a separate open source library. At more or less the same time, Google came up with Android Live Data, which in many ways is a very similar concept, but it's more tied to Android, while signals are a platform-independent implementation, as long as the platform understands Scala. So what is a signal? In short, a signal is an event stream with a cache. It's a very simple, small distinction, but it's also a very powerful one. Whereas an event stream holds no internal state, except for the collection of subscribers, and just passes on events it receives, a signal keeps the last value it received. A new subscriber function registered in an event stream will be called only when a new event is published. A new subscriber function registered in a signal will be called immediately or as soon as possible in the given execution context, and it will be called with the current value of the signal, unless the signal is not initialized yet, and then again it will be called when the value changes. A signal is also able to compare a new value published in it with the old one. The new value will be passed on only if it is different. Thus, a signal can help us with optimizing performance on both ends. As a cache for values, which otherwise would require expensive computations to produce them every time we need them, and also as a way to ensure that subscriber functions are called only when the value actually changes, but not when the result of the intermediate computation is the same as before. You can think of it as of traffic lights. You are the driver. You come to the crossroads and check the traffic lights. That means you subscribe to them, but also you immediately get the current value and can act on it. If it's green, you go. If it's red or yellow, you stop and wait for a change. So, one advantage is that in some cases you don't have to wait. If it was an event stream, you would have to stop each time and wait until a new event would tell you that it's safe to go. In case of a signal, if you see a green light as the current value, you don't have to stop. But there's also another advantage in that if, for any reason, the lights compute their new value and that value is the same as before, no new event comes. In that case, for you it's completely transparent that anything was computed. You wait for a different value, not the same value computed again. The second example is quite unrealistic if we talk about traffic lights, but consider this. This is a signal of int, and let's say we want to perform some complex computations only if the value of the signal is even. And let's assume for the sake of argument that we actually don't have to perform complex computations every single time, but only if the value of the signal becomes even initially, or if it changes from odd to even later. As we can see here, now the computations are also performed when the value changes from one even number to another even number. That's not optimal, but let's say it's not invalid. Let's say the result is the same as before, and we only waste some CPU time this way. But we can do better. We can change the signal, we can map it, and then make a for each only after the mapping, and that new mapped signal is of a Boolean value. The for each of that signal will be called only if the Boolean changes and becomes true. That is, if the original number value becomes even from being odd previously, or from an empty initialized signal. But if the number changes from one even number to another even number, the value of the mapped signal just stays the same. And so, because no change happened, the for each part is not executed at all, and the complex computations are not executed. I think with this I will finish this talk. You can look at the GitHub, where the code of wire signals is stored. You can read the documentation, together with Scala docs. And if you want to play with it, you can just use SVT and download the package. My name is Maciek, you can always find me on Twitter. Thank you very much.